Welcome back. In this segment, we will talk briefly about assistive technology, universal design, and advocacy. Again, please take a look at some of the resources we've included in Digging Deeper. We've included links that will give you access to a tremendous amount of information on these topics. As described by the National Center on Accessible Information, Technology, and Education, assistive technology is technology used by individuals with disabilities in order to perform functions that might otherwise be difficult or impossible. Assistive technology can include mobility devices such as walkers and wheelchairs, as well as hardware, software, and peripherals that assist people with disabilities in accessing computers and other information technologies. For example, people with limited hand function may use a keyboard with large keys or a special mouse to operate a computer. People who are blind may use software that reads text on the screen in a computer-generated voice. People with low vision may use software that enlarges screen content. People with speech impairments may use a device that speaks out loud as they enter text via a keyboard. So with that, let's hear from a couple of our guest speakers about what they have to say about their use of assistive technology.
The barriers I experience now are not as bad as my, like my grandfather. My grandfather in the past, back in the 40s, I'm not sure what 40 year, but he would want to visit a friend. He would drive to their house just to see them at home. And if they were home, or if the door was locked, he would have to wave, try to get their attention. If they weren't at home, we'd have to write and leave a note, leave it at the door, and drive all the way back home. There was a lot of barriers that he experienced that I have not. So I'm really fortunate to be living in today's times. Because of my phone, and I can make a phone call. I can make a phone call just like anyone else, except I have to use an interpreter. There's a service called Video Relay Services, and I can use that to connect to an interpreter on a kind of a TV screen or a phone screen, and I can sign. Let me go back just a little bit. And they can call the person through the phone, and I will sign to the interpreter on the screen, and then she will voice for me to the person who's receiving the message. And then the interpreter will sign back to me what the other person has said, so I can see it. So the barriers I experience, the experience I experience are almost minimal. They're not eliminated, but they're really pretty minimal. Most of the time, it's attitudes of people out in the world that are, and how they perceive deafness.
If you can't see, it's assumed that everyone dresses you and like picks out your clothes. That's not true. There are aids that help people even who are totally blind, that tells them what color their shirt is. They have devices and even iPhone apps now where they tell you what color something is. Technology is ever-changing, and it's fantastic. So I do know how to dress myself. I have arms and legs that, you know, I can do everything myself. And that's something that people seem to forget sometimes. It's like, oh, how did you get here? How did you dress yourself? Are common questions that I receive a lot.
Once you tell somebody or show them, this is how I do this, this is how we can do that, there are alternate ways. And you see that light bulb go on? The acceptance and willingness to work with you becomes much greater because the general public just doesn't know about things like screen reading software, magnification programs, cell phones that'll talk to you. People see me using my phone and they're like, how does that blind guy use an all-touch screen phone? And there's tech out there that makes it work. And once you explain that, it tends to relieve a lot of the pressure and, I'll use the word fear, created by an individual's lack of experience with a disability.
Another concept that helps people live better, more accessible lives is universal design. Again, an entire MOOC could and probably should be devoted to this topic. Much like with the other ideas we've discussed today, There are a variety of resources available for you to learn more about this topic. Now, the following definition comes from Ron Mace at the North Carolina State University's Center for Universal Design. And what he states is, universal design is the design of products and environments to be usable by all people to the greatest extent possible without the need for adaptation or specialized design. Obviously here, the idea, the intent of universal design is to simplify life for everyone by making products, communications, and the built environment more usable by as many people as possible at little or no extra cost. Universal design benefits people of all ages and abilities. An example of universal design that we've used throughout the course is closed captioning. I mention this because captioning benefits everyone. I value it because I process visual information more readily than auditory information. In other words, I learn more by reading than listening. There are many other people who benefit because they may have English as a second language. And there are others who need captioning because of their hearing loss. Related to this last idea, let's hear from Bobby as he talks about his perspectives on captioning.
I don't want to watch anything that's not closed captioned. It doesn't matter how good it is. I refuse. Because I'm lost. I don't understand what's going on. And I feel like I'm one step down. I love closed captioning. I remember before closed captioning was really invented and used. I'm going off a little bit on this, but before closed captioning was really invented, my mother would sit by the TV and interpret my favorite shows for me. Don't get me wrong, I love my mother for doing that, but closed captioning really is a way better option. Hands down. But when closed captioning started coming out, I started to get excited. I started to feel a sense of thrill. Watching TV with captioning on, be able to understand everything that they said. Sometimes my mom would leave things out because, you know, it might be hard to interpret just generally, you know. But I was really excited. So happy to see closed captioning on TV. And years later, it shows up in a movie theater sometimes. Oh, what a thrill that is.
Also want to mention, before we close here, the importance of advocacy. And again, just scratching the surface on this, because when we think about advocacy, it's not only from the individual standpoint. You know, individuals need to advocate for themselves, families need to advocate for their needs as well as the needs of their children. But even broadly speaking, this entire course is kind of an effort of advocacy to inform, educate, so that we conduct ourselves as a society and develop things in a way that is much more inclusive of everyone. And to do that, we need to be able to identify barriers, identify the prejudices that are out there, identify the misconceptions and myths that are there, and importantly, address those. Educate, gain experience, work with, but learn that those things do exist. One of the best ways I found to help people become more aware of barriers, especially physical barriers, is to conduct an accessibility audit. It's basically a sheet that you can download. You go to any place, and it lists a number of things in terms of, can you get in without using a step? Is there signage? Is there, if you're in the restroom, is there an accessible stall for a person? And I will tell you, at least it's been my experience with the students in my class on campus, that by doing this accessibility audit, that I ruin them. And what I mean by that is that once you are attuned to, once you're made aware of how inaccessible much of life is, you can't turn that off. You now know that. And that's my hope for you as you listen to this and as you go out and do that assignment, is become aware. Start looking now and seeing, And as you have the ability to make changes, please do so. So in summary, as we look at this particular segment, we hit on family support, assistive technology, universal design. And as an entire lesson, you know, we think about this notion of very long history of segregation, strong push historically as well as currently for institutionalization, putting people in nursing homes. And yet, in reality, as we think about it, it is so very important to have choice and have that ability to be where you're most comfortable and want to be.
So with that, I'll close today's lesson. And next week will be a similarly broad kind of lesson because we're going to talk about employment. But employment is key to a lot of things. So I hope you'll join us. Thank you.